Welcome, Adgild. It is great to have you again, as always, and talk about how the retail sector is adapting to the six forces that are influencing the consumer industry. 6 months ago, we had this conversation about what the status quo was at that moment, or maybe a test in time where the industry and the sector is. We focused on changing consumer and mass to micro. This time, I would like to focus on one force, but two elements within it. So the force is the shifting economics, policies, and power. And within that, the increasing cost levels and the increasing pressure on regulatory compliance. So let me start with the first one. How do you see the cost levels evolve in retail?
Yes, so cost is always important within retail because it's a very low margin business typically. But I think we looked at this at a European level this year, and it's clear that where retail has always been difficult, all of the cost trends, typically speaking, have been pointing in the wrong direction, right? So one of the key drivers within retail clearly is payroll, due to the shifting minimum wage mandates in most European countries. I think in the past 2-3 years, minimum wage has gone up by 20%. That is a profound impact on the P&L of the average retailer. If you look at the shift, the continued shift to online, that makes every borderline profitable transaction a borderline unprofitable retail transaction. Energy inflation, food inflation is subsiding a little bit. But the thing that I think is also really, really, really impactful is the increased cost of money. Yeah. With the rising interest rates, cost of money and the kind of the annual fees being paid on that is significantly higher than a few years ago. So in particular for the more leveraged retailers, that is a further kind of pressure financially that's impacting on their profitability.
Yeah, and you don't see the ability of those companies to roll forward those costs in the prices, because rising prices, of course, cause inflation again.
Yeah. Yeah, and so most of those retailers are unable to pass through 100% of those increased costs to consumers, just because the consumer landscape is also constrained with less disposable incomes, and hence they're having to swallow it in their profitability. And so within grocery in Europe, I think we've seen a 20% decline in profitability in, I think, the last 7-8 years. If you consider now that the average grocer delivers like 1.6% net profit, it's just a really hard business.
Yeah. And then on top, we see the regulatory pressure coming, right? Yeah. There's an enormous tsunami of regulations and compliance required. So how is that going to affect? That's probably going to add cost on top of the already high cost pressure.
Yeah, I think most of the retailers that we speak to are kind of, you know, squinting and closing their eyes because they realize this is coming. The kind of the fine line between mandatory and not mandatory is allowing them to, I think, kick it down the curb a little bit longer. But some of the numbers we've seen for around required investments that retailers need to make to deliver upon the regulatory requirements. Yeah, I mean, those are again profoundly negative implications on the P&L of the retail business. So it's not going to get easier.
No, and then the question comes up, of course, how they're going to not going to sit and wait till the margins go down even further. So what are retailers doing at the moment to get out of that squeeze?
So I think there's the the further improving operational excellence can only go so far. Everyone talks about generative AI, but the reality is I think that's still like 6, 12, 18 months away before that really starts potentially impacting some of the operational improvements. You see in grocery in particular in the last 2 years, more announcements on sourcing partnerships arising to drive off some synergies and some benefits there. But in particular, what you see the big leading players doing is really starting to look at alternative income streams. Yeah. And so in grocery, you see the big players accelerating aggressively into retail media. On the general merchandising side, you see again the leaders looking at their assets and their brands and rethinking, who am I? And so you see John Lewis moving into real estate. You see a company like IKEA starting to redefine itself as not just around products, but around life at home, with all of the implications that that comes with it. So they're starting to redefine, who am I and how do I make money?
Yeah, and so that's fantastic development that leaves behind a little bit the core retail practice. So who's going to survive in that core retail practice? What is the key opportunity for those players to make sure that they capture the customer?
So I think there's probably three points. The first point is that on the outskirts of the retail market, there's opportunities there. So kind of the lower cost side, the Actions, the Primarks, etc., with a unique proposition and awesome operational excellence, they can, I think, continue to be strong and to thrive. On the other extreme, you've got the luxury players who, again, I think will be reasonably protected. But it's the middle ground, the expanding middle ground, which is the increasingly hard place to I think, prosper. And there, I think the big players who do invest in these new monetary models, I think, have really good opportunities, because I do think there's a lot of hidden value in retail. For the smaller players, I think it's going to become more and more challenging, just because the bigger players will be using some of the investments and the income from the other delivery, from the other monetary models. They'll be reinvesting that into their core retail model, making it harder for their traditional players to survive. And so I would imagine that there will be further kind of consolidation jumps as well in that middle market.
So the scaling opportunity.
Either merger acquisition activity or collaboration, such as you see on the sourcing side in grocery happening, but then happening more widely.
Clear. And what we also find from research is that the convergence of industries, so for example, retail and health, we spoke about it in a previous conversation. How do you see that evolve? Because we see a large part of the discretionary spend of consumer going into health and well-being. Is that still an opportunity for retail?
Yes, so I think it is. It is for those retailers that have kind of the brand equity to kind of operate in that space. But I do think that what we see, and we talked about this last time, is that the share of consumer spend that goes to products is declining. The share of spend that's going to services is expanding. So a product service mix around healthcare, well-being is definitely, I think, a big opportunity. The caveat therein is that that's exactly also the part of the market where the consumer products companies are all looking at hungrily as roles to play as sources of income. And clearly the tech companies are also making big moves to that area. So it's an opportunity, but it's not just an opportunity for retail. And it's a marketplace with a bunch of different competitors who live and breathe differently than the average retailer does.
Yeah, so it sounds like a real reinvention of the whole industry, right? The whole sector, and a lot of convergence opportunities are happening. It was, as mentioned, it being very exciting to talk to you and have that perspective that you just shared. I'm looking forward to the next one, because in 6 months a lot has happened already again, and to follow up on this conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dominic. Much appreciated.